If you have your Bibles with you, we'd ask you to turn to Psalms. Psalms 46 is where we'll take our text this morning. Continue to pray always for me as your pastor that the Lord might lead me and might do what I would have what He would have me to do. Psalms 46 in the very first verse. Psalms 46 in the first verse, the Bible says, God is our refuge and strength, a very present help in trouble. Therefore will not we fear, though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, and though the mountains shake, and the swelling thereof, Selah. There is a river, the streams whereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, she shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. The heathen raged, the kingdoms are moved. He uttered his voice, the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Come, behold the works of the Lord, what desolations he hath made in the earth. He maketh wars to cease unto the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in fire. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you and praise you and give you an honor and glory that's due your name this morning. Lord God, we pray for strength and understanding to preach your word. Lord, we understand and know there's nothing of us without you, Lord God, and we pray today that you would just honor your word with the Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray that you bless each one that was mindful to come this way this morning and had an interest in your word, and that you would bless them for that. God, protect our church. Help us to be the people that we'd be willing to do what you would have us to do. Lord God, we pray this morning simply this, that you would meet with us and that you'd stir your people to closeness and to service for you, Lord. And we'd be faithful to give you the praise and the glory and the honor for it all. For it is in Christ's name we do pray. Amen. Now, we'll be preaching this morning on the thought, remember the God we serve. Now, we live in a day and age today where very frequently we want to take on thoughts about God that are not biblical. We want to pull in what the world is taught about God, and we kind of forget the God we really serve. And some things that you really need to remember about God is He don't need you, you need Him. He's not in any way, in any obligation to you, in any sort of fashion. What he does by His mercy. That's the God we serve. He isn't beholding to anybody. So as Korah begins to write, he writes this, God is three things. God is our refuge. Now, to even need a refuge, you know what has to happen? There has to be a battle. A refuge is a place when the battle's real hot and heavy that you can go and kind of gather your thoughts and get ready for the battle a second time. That is a refuge. Now, God is your refuge. And listen, this war will not be over until one or two things happens. He says, come up hither, or you're out here laid in one of these graves beside the church building. That's when it will be over. So let me tell you this from personal experience, you're going to need a refuge. There's not one of us that's strong enough to keep the battle going all the time. So from time to time, you need a refuge. And that refuge is the Lord God Almighty. And that is where certainly we as the Lord's people need to flee to. And with that said, I dare say many of us frequently don't go to the right refuge. We want other things to kind of re-energize us instead of the Word of God. So as the psalmist is writing, he says, God is our refuge and strength. Now, listen, you know, we live in a day today with very anemic, weak Christians. We live in a day where Christians are easily bowled over by the enemy, and the reason why is because they have no strength. And the reason they have no strength is this, is because they really don't understand where their strength comes from. It comes from God and not the other way around. You know what? If you're feeling weak this morning, it ought to be your prayer that He would strengthen you. That He would give you what you need, because certainly it's not the other way around. And so as the psalmist Korah is writing, he says, He's my refuge, my strength, and a very present help in trouble. Now, let me say this. When he says a very present help, that's like almost saying like this: He's always there when I'm in trouble. Now, let me say this. If you've got yourself there on your own, you're on your own. But if you're doing what the Lord would have you to do, and you're near unto the Lord, and when trouble comes up, He's going to be there. He's going to be present every time to stand in your back and to be what you need in that hour. He's a very present help in time of need. And I think really today why there is so much discouragement among God's people is that we've forgotten these principles that He is going to be there. He is going to be present when we need Him. Verse 2, therefore will not we fear though the earth be removed. Now, if you get the principles, the first three principles in verse 1, verse 2 will make more sense to you. So he says, therefore, because that's true, we won't be moved. You know what? I can come to this conclusion here. There's a lot of people that don't know those principles, because I've seen a lot of people moved. I've seen a lot of people say, I would never do that. I'll never leave the church. I'll never put on a pair of breeches. I'll never go to a ball game and sit in the Lord's house. And you watch them long enough, and you know what? They do it. And you know what? The only thing I'd say is they've been removed. They move from their steadfastness. They move. And so when we see that among God's people, we can come to this, that the real problem is they're missing some of that in verse 1. Therefore, because we have all this, we will not fear. I see a lot of people scared today. Though the earth be removed, and though the mountains be carried into the midst of the sea. And you know what? You look around here today, and you see, if you see physical catastrophe going on, people, you know, that gets their attention more than anything else. They can be in a situation where they've not heard from God in 50 years, but you let a little wind blow up, and man, they're wringing their hands, and they're all upset. You know, the only conclusion I come to is they don't know the master of the wind.
Yeah.
You know, tornado's coming, and there's not one thing you can do about it. Seek out and cry to God. You know who controls that tornado? The very hand of it is our God. So why do we get upset? And so we very frequently forget the principles of why we should trust the Lord entirely. Verse 3, though the waters thereof roar and be troubled, and they will, though the mountains shake and the swelling thereof. So I want you to see, first of all, that it's not just smooth sailing. You are going to have some difficult problems. And if you don't, there's probably another issue that's a spiritual one. And the devil doesn't even see fit to waste time giving you trouble. But he says, though the waves... And you know what? It's going to happen. The thing with this, when the storm comes, is what are you going to do? It's not if the storm comes. When the storm comes, do you have a plan? Do you know what you're going to do when the storm comes up, or are you simply going to play it by ear? So we as the Lord's people, we need to understand and know that a storm is a very real possibility. In fact, it's part of God's plan, and He's coming. Then He says, though the mountains shall shake with the swelling thereof, Selah. Now, this word Selah is very interesting, and I searched it out recently, and it's almost like a man, but it's even a little bit better than that. And I think this is very interesting. You know, there's no direct translation for that word in any other language besides the Hebrew. The closest is we got is the rock. It literally means the rock. So when all this calamity is going around you and coming your way, do you have the rock? Is Selah there for you? Is he in his person? Do you have something that you can depend on? You know what? We're fixing to start a brand new year tomorrow. Do you have the rock? You know what? I don't know what's going to happen in 2018. I don't know what there is in forward for us. You know what? At the end of 2016, I didn't think we'd be, I didn't think some of the people that's left would have been gone, but they have. So 2018 is coming. You know what? You know why I'm not stressed about it? Selah. The rock's there for me. He's present. He's going to do exactly what he wants to do, and he's going to accomplish it after his own will, and all things will be good. So I ask you this morning, do you know the rock? Do you understand what the principles of trusting the Lord is, even when it's difficult? Verse 4, there is a river, and the streams thereof shall make glad the city of God. Now, I think this is very interesting because he speaks of the river, some attribute it to Jordan. I really don't think that's it. I think what he's saying, the river is God. And that's how we're nourished. That's how we're taken care of. That's where our water comes from. And so, we as the Lord's people, we need to understand and know, are you really hearing from God or are you not? Now, listen, we live in a day and age today where most men will not preach to you because they're scared of losing their job. So what kind of quality of water are you getting this morning? You know, there was two types of water when they were in the desert, was there not? A lot about water in the Bible. I guess that's why Campbellite people think you need to be baptized. But, you know, there was water that came from a rock. There was sweet water. And there was good water. There was bitter water. And so we see here that the Lord God said that this is where we need to be plugged into. That the tributaries would come up. There is a river, and the springs thereof shall make glad the city of God, the holy place, the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her. Now, if you don't get anything else from this morning, you remember this. God is with Israel, and he always will be. In fact, it would violate his honesty and his truthfulness to take aim against his own bride, his own betrothed. He'll never do that. You know what? I don't care what you feel about President Trump or anything like that, but I will say this. He's a friend to Israel, and that's a good thing. And so we find here that this situation ought to be that we would want to nurture Israel along the way. Because it's the apple of his eyes. There is a river, and the streams thereof shall make the city of God, shall make glad the city of God, the holy place of the tabernacles of the Most High. God is in the midst of her, and shall not be moved. God shall help her, and that right early. Now let me say this. He certainly has always done that for Israel. But because of their sin, there's many times where he's had to step back. And you know what? There are many times in our life, no doubt, that he has to step back from us too. But okay, if that's the way you want it, that's the way you're going to get it. And let us learn a little something about what the nature of our nature and what sin nature is too. And you know what? When we've done that enough times, we'll finally learn the lesson. We'll finally say, you know what? I can't handle it. So I can't handle sin. I can't even be around it because it consumes me. And so he was very faithful to his statement, but you see, miraculously, in 1948, she becomes a nation again. And then just this year, the year we're finishing out, 2017, our president says Jerusalem is the capital. And you know, of all the things that he's done that's been hated this first year of his presidency, that's hated the most. And you know why? Because no doubt, it was just the design of God. And when that happens, it makes all hell and makes all hell upset. So they kicked up their heels against him. So we find then that we, as the Lord's people, should always take note of what's going on in Israel. The heathen raged, the kingdoms were moved, he uttered his voice and the earth melted. The Lord of hosts is with us, the God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. Now, verse 7 says, the God of Jacob is our refuge, Selah. You know what? I don't know what your issues are this morning and how you might be upset, how much you may be down and out, but I do know this. Whatever your situation, God is our refuge, the rock. You know, you go around in Stewart County, you can still find a few old houses built on rocks instead of foundation. And you know what's this? The miraculous thing to me, they're still there. Stewart County, huge iron mining town. For the first century, it was here. You know, you ever thought about this? All those little towns, Bear Spring, Carlisle, down in land between the lakes, all those towns had company houses. None of them are left, not even one, because believe me, I've looked. But the furnace is still there. And you know why? It's rock. It's still there. So this morning, that's where you ought to run to. When problems is on the way, when trouble is in your face, you go to the rock. You know, and I'll say this, the rock will always give you directions and always will lead you in the right way. That ought to be where we desire to be as the Lord's people. Come, behold the works of the Lord. Now, the writer here gives us another idea. If you're discouraged and if you're ready to quit, come and behold the works of the Lord. What do you see when you wake up every day? You know, this morning I got up and I took a shower, stirred up the fire a little bit. And you know what? Nobody had to help me a bit. I did every bit of it on my own. That's the work of the Lord. When you can't get up and take your own shower, you'll see that for that one day. That is the work of the Lord. Came here by my own free will, if you want to call it that. Came here under my own strength. Came into the house of the Lord, good warm building to meet in. That's the work of the Lord. Yeah. You know what? I had the freedom to do as I pleased this morning. I didn't have the government hovering down over me saying, hey, you can't do that. That's a work of the Lord. Good warm building to meet in. Listen, a lot of places cold and damp and it ain't but 15 degrees out there. You know what? God's been good to us. I'm actually hot. I can fan myself right now. God is good. Come and see the works of the Lord. And on top of all those physical blessings, you know what? I can't understand it, but I do know this. The Lord Jesus saved my soul. I do not face eternity with any dread whatsoever. I don't have to worry about in the miseries of hell for the lost. He saved me. What else can I say? Amen. God's been good to me. He said, come and see the works of the Lord. Look at them little babies. I mean, come and see the works of the Lord. We ought to praise Him and give Him great honor and great glory. But what do we do? Now we get our mother grubs and, you know, blah, 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 blah. You know what? Start picking out the good in your life. Don't tell me what you can't do. Tell me what you can do. Don't tell me how you've been beat up this week. Tell me how He's lifted you up in the beat up places. Because you know what? If you were knocked down, knocked around this week, newsflash, you're going to get knocked around next week too. And you know what? The week after that, you're going to get knocked around again because we are a hated and despised people. That's why the Bible calls us pilgrims and strangers. We're odd to the rest of the world. And listen, if you're not, you probably have a spiritual problem going on. Yeah. So we as the Lord's people, we just need to take great encouragement and lift His name up because He says, come and behold the works of the Lord. What desolations He's made in the earth. Now when you think about the desolation, I often think about Sodom and Gomorrah. There was nothing left.
Nearly so.
I mean, just the full wrath of God poured out. I think about Lot's wife. His wrath, what did she know that saw? There's nothing left. And you know what? We need to understand and look around when God makes a judgment like that. And we need to look at the desolation. But I'll say this too. Look at yourself. You know, I walked through some pretty desolate times. And every one of them was my own doing. Every one of them was because I had withdrew myself from the Lord. And then He said, okay, you go and do what you please. And you know what? We need to understand that those desolate times, we need to learn from them. We need to understand and say, hey, you know what? This happened because of the way that I do. This happened as a judgment, as unto sin. This is me that has done this. He maketh wars to cease and the end of the earth. He breaketh the bow and cutteth the spear in sunder. He burneth the chariot in fire. Now verse 9 says that one day war will stop. And you know what? No matter what kind of peace plan this earth has, there will never be peace until the Lord Jesus Christ rules from Jerusalem. And then there'll be peace. Until then, there will be a war going on somewhere. The Middle East, listen, has been a hot spot literally all my life. We sent troops there when I was in high school, and they're still there today. 35 years later, we're still there. And you know what? I don't see no getting out of it, do you? I really don't. I don't see us ever being there. And you know what? That will go on and on, because you know what? You know what war is? It's the result of sin, and sin has not been taken care of yet. But it will be. And so then we as the Lord's people, we need to understand and know that we ought to give Him the praise and the glory that's due His name, because He's still in control. Be still and know that I am God. Now, for someone like me, this is a very difficult thing to do. Be still. Probably all my children, at least in this, maybe only this, Matthew is most likely this. He can't be still, and I never could have either. I've got to be doing something. It was worse when I was younger. But you know, the problem with that is this. You don't see much God when you're doing everything yourself. You don't see God in a hurricane until you step back and say, you know what? That's His finger twirling the water. Everything's going to be fine. And listen, when you look about across the devastation, and I've just seen it in pictures of a hurricane. I mean, you don't even know what to do. There's so much to do, you don't even know where to start. But God's in it. God offered that, so therefore it must be good. Be still. Instead of constantly running, I've got to do this, I've got to do that, I've got to get that done. Just be still for a minute. When you get some really bad news, just take a second, be still. And know He's God. He's in God. He's God in everything that happens. I encourage you in 2018 to be still a little bit more than you were in 2017 and see God for who He is. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the heathen. Now, I want you to especially do, and you underline in your Bible, you get that part. I will be exalted among the heathen. And you know what? He's accomplished that unto Himself through the person of Christ. He is exalted among what was heathen, non-Jews, nations. Even today, He's being lifted up as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords among a people that were no people. That's what Christ does. So He promised this. He accomplished this. And He did it. And that is the day which we now live. I will be exalted in the earth. The Lord of hosts is with us. The God of Jacob is our refuge. Selah, or the rock. Now, I ask you this morning, do you depend on the Lord Jesus Christ like a rock? Do you think he's firm enough to hold you up? Do you think he's stout enough to be what you can depend on? Or is he some little just figment of your imagination? Because see, when trouble comes, it really does make a difference how you see that. Because see, otherwise, when trouble comes, you'll be wringing your hands and wondering what you're going to do next. And instead, you really believe that he is the rock and he's what you're standing on. And he, you know, it's just like when Moses was in the battle. And as long as he had his hands up, everything was going good. And finally, they scooted up a rock and he sat down on the rock. See, he was sitting on the rock. And Aaron and the other boy took his hands and held his hands up for him. And you know what? By the end of the day, the battle was won. Do you believe in the rock or do you not?
Yeah.
See, how close you are unto the Lord in 2018 really is your perception of what the rock is about. You know, you hear on and on and on about sovereign grace. But what about living grace? Sovereign grace just means God is sovereign and he's authored everything after the counsel of his own will. And that is a very biblical position. However, when you say amen to the elect, meaning the chosen of God, what about your pocketbook? Is he sovereign there? He certainly is. See, that's the thing about, he can't be sovereign in one area and not be sovereign in another area. It's all or none. So he made last night a 9-degree night, or else he didn't. In the springtime, when tornadoes ripped through Tennessee, you know what? Either he authored that, or he didn't author the calmness and the sunniness that we have today. It's all or none. So then why do we get so upset? You know what? I think a lot of times we really couldn't say Selah. I think that's one reason American people don't understand it, because we don't look at him as a rock. We don't look at him as the help that he is. We really look at him as something a lot less. And so then, do you put this into practice? Do you look on him as the rock and put it into practice? Now, I want to go very quickly back to the book of 1 Samuel. And we'll see a time in David's life, very familiar verses of Scripture, where he stood out when nobody else would and viewed God as the rock. 1 Samuel chapter 17, I want to read verse 25. 1 Samuel 17, verse 25. The Bible says this, "And the men of Israel said, have you seen this man that has come up? Surely to defy Israel he has come up, and it shall be that the man who killeth him, the king will enrich him with great riches, and will give him his daughter, and make his father's house free in Israel." Now, I want you to see David had gone down to visit his brothers in the battlefield, and Goliath was a huge, huge problem. About 9.5 feet tall, a huge man. And listen, you know what? There are problems I have faced that at least looked that big at the time, that I really didn't know what I was going to do next. But is he God or is he not? Listen, in 2018, there are going to be some big problems that stand between you and serving the Lord God. And you know what? What we want to do today, and the longer I study, and I've studied this for some months now, because really trying to understand throwing the mountain into the sea. Well, the principle is that is to get it out of the way. And could he serve? Yes, he could throw the East Tennessee mountains over into the sea on any given day. But what else he can do is get what looks like a problem to me out of my way. When I'm serving the Lord, he can move it. He can get it out of the way. So what stood between Israel being a free nation and being prosperous was Goliath. Was the problem going to be addressed, or were they going to let it go? And for months and months they had sat in the battle line, no one willing to step up, no one willing to say, hey, this man is defying Israel, until a small young shepherd boy came out and said, who is this man? Well, what's he doing? You know what? When are we going to turn our eyes on one day and say, look, what is going on here? We have men marrying men and women marrying women. What has happened? See, David wasn't in the battle. And when he got down in the battle, he's like, what is going on? That is a Philistine. He is a heathen. What is going on? But you know what?
We do the same thing.
You know what? Sometimes I think I'll puke if one more person says, well, that's just the day we live in. Well, so what? What does that have to do with anything? The Bible says this, I am the Lord, I change not. And so, if that is true, and it certainly is, then why should we get used to sin? Instead of being outraged, David's brothers, instead of being upset, they had got used to it, and they were even scared. And so David made that bold statement. Now, if you will, go with me to now verse 37. And David, moreover, the Lord had delivered me out of the paw of the lion and out of the paw of the bear. He would deliver me out of the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said unto David, go, and the Lord be with thee. Now, I want you to see also that David had a little preparatory training. See, he didn't start with a 9.5-foot man. He started out with two animals that he had to kill on two different occasions to defend the lambs. See, you know, man, one of your jobs is to defend your family. And I don't mean just, you know, providing for them. That is absolutely a requirement. I don't mean just giving them a house to live in. That is absolutely a requirement. But I mean defending them against the prey. And this is exactly, so David's job was to be over these sheep, and when the enemy came their way, he defeated them, a lion and a bear, a 17, 16, 15-year-old boy, literally killing a bear with a slingshot. You know what? You know what worked is because he trusted God. You know what? In man's eyes, slingshots just don't kill bears. And you know what? With man's understanding, they don't. But with God's ability, they can. So you may not have anything left this year but a bag full of rocks. But if that's all you've got, you use them from God and you face the enemy. You know, do you ever get sick of people living defeated? I do. I get sick of people, whoa, with me. I'm like, come on. We live in the greatest nation that's ever been, the most best opportunities that have ever been around. We have a free Bible. We can go and preach the gospel wherever we want, whenever we please. What do we got to be sorry about? Nothing whatsoever. We ought to rejoice and be glad and lift up His name this morning for exactly who He is. And so David had a willingness, and he'd also been trained, and he had trained himself really for the day that he'd be called to battle. Verse 46, this day will the Lord deliver thee unto my hand, and I will smite thee and take thy head from thee. I will give thy carcass give the carcasses of the host of the Philistines this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, and all that the earth may know, there is a God in Israel. Now, I want you to see in verse 46, not only does he say, yeah, I'm going to cut your head off, and all the Philistines is going to be a feast for the fowls of the air. Not only am I going to take your leader down, I'm going to take all of you down. You know, that's a pretty bold statement for a 17-year-old boy, isn't it? Yeah. And you know why he made it? He believed in God. I really don't think he had that much confidence in himself. In fact, I know that he didn't. Because when he got ready to go, you know, he had Saul's armor on. He said, I can't wear this.
Yeah.
He set it aside because he was depending on God. He knew his God was able. And so as we approach battles, in the year to come, you just remember this. God is able. He can do it. He can approach it. It's not your battle. It belongs unto God, and let Him do it. Verse 47, and all the assembly shall know that the Lord saveth not with the sword of the spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and He will give you unto our hands. Now, well, you know, one wonderful thing that David already had learned as a young boy, he said, the battle is the Lord's. He understood and knew that God was the deliverer. You know, the Lord Jesus is just referred to that on two different occasions, as the deliverer. And what does He deliver us from? Ourselves. Everybody says, does he deliver you from Satan? No. Because Satan's already bugged me today. Right? But He did deliver me from myself. He saved my soul. Turned me into something that I wasn't. And so then we, as the Lord's people, we need to be able to be like David was, and just stand on the rock, just be steady, just continue on. And it came to pass when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hasted and ran toward the enemy to meet the Philistine. So I want you to see that how Goliath had been really kind of touting Israel as, man, he'd run right for him. And that would scare him. You know what? The enemy's going to run after you this year. He's going to run after you with whatever thing you like the best. Whatever thing gives you the most physical comfort, he's going to come at you with it. He's going to scare you if he can. And you know what? Instead of running, David ran right toward him. You know what? We can't keep going around the problem. You've got to meet it face on sometime. You got to meet it right in the eye. Whatever it is, if it's a self problem, if it's a problem you have with other people, if it's a problem you have with me as your pastor, whatever it is, you've got to meet some problems face on and say, this is what's going on. And you know the story, David went right down there. He took one of the stones he had in his pouch, he slung it around and let it go, hit the line right there, and brought him down. Now, another thing that we as the Lord's people sometimes don't do is finish the job. Now, a lot of people will misquote this. Did the rock kill Goliath? No. It knocked him down, and it knocked him out. But David still had to cut off Goliath's head. That's what killed him. See, I think too many times when these spiritual problems come into our lives, we knock the problem down, but we never kill it. Now, had David taken that approach, you know what? Eventually, Goliath would have recovered, and he'd come up better, madder than he'd ever been before, and ready to do something more to the people of God. But at his own promise, he says, I want to take your head off. And once he knocked him down, he took Goliath's own sword and cut his head off with it. And that was a great and wondrous victory. And then what we see among God's people is that now that they were encouraged, they flew on the Philistines. And there was an unbelievable victory that day. In other words, it's catching. When you learn to rest on the rock, other people will learn to rest on the rock as well. When you put your confidence not in the things of this world, but in the things of the Lord God, other people will see that. That's why the Bible is very clear. You train up your children in the ways that they should go. You let them understand a lot more than just reading this book to them. You let them see you trusting God in your present life, and that will be a great encouragement to them. One more place. In 2 Timothy, very familiar verses of Scripture. 2 Timothy chapter 4, in the very first verse. Now, I don't know how long before Paul's death this occurred. One part of scripture actually refers to as Paul the aged. So I'm believing that he lived to be an older man. I believe that he, it could have been some time after this letter, I don't know. But one thing's for sure, that Paul was thinking about death. You know, the only thing I can tell you concerning death is this, is don't wait too long to consider it. If you're redeemed, you consider it anyway. If you're lost, you really consider it. You look at it carefully and you consider what death is all about. So Paul was probably nearing his death, and he begins to look at some things and share them with Timothy. I charge thee, in other words, I charge thee therefore before God and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. You know, as Paul is probably really thinking, I'm fixing to move off the scene. Somebody's got to take this up. You know what? Should the Lord not come back in the next 25 years or before, y'all going to need a new pastor. I'll be 50 in a year. And you know what? I've seen most pastors last to about 75, and then they'll preach occasionally. But you know what? It's physically demanding to preach the Word of God. And it takes a pretty acute mind. And when you're 75, you don't have either. And so Paul was concerned that problems could be on the way. So he says, Timothy, you need to preach. I'm moving off the scene, and you need to preach the Word. Well, you need to understand what this Word teaches. You need to understand the truth of the Word of God. Preach the Word. Be instant, or ready, or moving in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. Now, I won't get into that, but I do want you to see that two-thirds of the ministry is reproving and rebuking. And I'll say in the modern day, that's the least used portion of the ministry. I like to exhort people. You know what? The Lord Jesus is coming. That's an exhortation. But until then, you keep serving Him. If you have sin in your life, get it out. If you upset your brother and sister in Christ, make it straight. So, two-thirds of what I just did was rebuking. How many people think you see that in most churches today? Paul was concerned about it, was he not? Paul was saying, hey, this is what you need to do. This is the reason that you're to preach. Verse 3, for the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and be turned unto fables. But watch thou in all things, endure affliction, do the work of an evangelist, make full proof of thy ministry. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Now, you know what helped him through that time, and his steadfastness spoke for itself. It was the rock. What about you? Is your life resting on the person of the Lord Jesus Christ? Is your testimony about you, or is it about Christ? What are you resting on this morning? What does your peace come from? What do you do? Listen, I have no idea what's ahead for us in the next year. But I want to be resting on the rock, don't you? I want to be resting on the one that not only knows, but has already offered it. And said, hey, it's going to be this way. That way, when the problems come up, I'm not upset. It doesn't
throw me for a loop. I'm ready. Are you serving him? Brother Judy?